Good morning, everyone. Thank you for being here. The talk I have for you this morning is about attacking waste in software. But before I do that, I want to tell you about a little story about attacking waste. When Lee called me to think about keynoting here, he said, write something down that you're interested in and just pop me an email about it. So I did, and there was a very quick feedback loop from him, which essentially said, I sure hope you didn't waste a lot of time on this. So then we had another quick feedback loop as I sat in a parking lot from a client quickly going through and saying, trying to figure out why he thought that that needed some attention. So in his service to attacking waste, he reeled me in. So this morning, my talk about attacking waste in software is really about three practices I believe we must embrace right now as we're moving through our lives as software people. All right, so to get you into some of the things that I've been thinking about, I first have to explain what waste is, and we have to think about that together. So have you think with me about where waste is and what it is. And then I'm going to introduce a system of waste that all of us can relate to, I think. It's a very large system that we're actually engaged in, and it's called planet Earth. I think most of us are here. And so then lead into some of the ideas that I've presented in some other talks yesterday on Flowpool Innovate with regard to using Lean as a guide to how I care about waste management. So as Lee said, I come from a passion around Agile, and that's led me to using Lean as a guide and overall framework for looking at what Agile practices would most benefit teams that I work with. Then I'm going to get right to the heart of it, which is what I want to do is present the notion for the 21st century of software development as seeking out a zero footprint, approaching as much as we can a zero footprint in what we do. And so the three practices I'll invite you to consider with me this morning in the next 50 minutes is software as a service, and then community as your marketing device, and then finally what I call fast throughput of features. So I'm going to explain a little bit about each of those and how they fit into systems and fixing systems problems that I had shown you in the systems problems in Planet Earth. And then we'll see if we have any time left over to talk about it together. So what is waste? This is where I ask you to think about going to the doctor and sitting down and the doctor saying, tell me where it hurts. Okay, so let's think about that together. What wastes do you associate with software? So first, look at what it takes for you to get your valued features into the hands of your valued customers. Okay, so what waste do you currently manage? What are you having to manage that could potentially be considered waste in getting your software products into their hands? So that's waste that you're having to juggle all the time. And what waste are you actually asking them to incur in order to get your value of your software products into their hands? So that's something I call shifting the burden, okay? So there's waste that we're managing and carrying around, and there's waste that they're potentially managing and carrying around. Secondly, what waste do you currently manage? So what waste is built into how you market, how you find out what should be in your software products that you're delivering to your customers? How much does that cost in your organization to hopefully get it right, to hopefully get the feature set right? And actually, who ends up ultimately deciding what should go into your software products? Okay, so do you have a decision model for figuring that out, and do you trust their judgments? Do you believe in the information they're giving you about the customer base or where the market is headed? And then finally, developing that software product, that value, we hope valued feature set that we learned from our product marketing group, What waste do you currently manage in creating the software products? Okay, and what are your ideation? What does it take for you to actually do the requirements, the investment to define the requirements, and then actually the operating expense, the coding and testing and recoding and retesting of stuff to finally get the software to your ultimate user, who then is the person who gives you the money back for it. So that's the whole gist of looking at the fact that my fear is that waste is sitting out there in all of those areas in how we've been traditionally getting software out. And so it's time to be open with one another, stand up and say, hi, my name's Jean, and I have a whole bunch of waste in what I do. All right. So why are we expending so many resources and so much energy pushing all these wastes around? Why would we continue that practice? Why would we not go after it aggressively and say that we must do something different? So one of the things that got me thinking about this was when I read this book by James Womack and Daniel T. Jones. Have any of you read this book, Lean Thinking? Okay. Well, that's a good one to help you understand at a very high level, without thinking specifically about software, how to look at waste. And they have five principles that they suggest will help you do that. So consider what value is, decide what value is, and concentrate on that, and look at what it takes for you to deliver value. They have something called the value stream, and there's a practice of value stream mapping to watch, now that you've figured out what's value, what's all the stuff around it that actually isn't value in what in the work that you're doing. And so then they offer these principles of how to aggressively go after the waste that you discovered in your value stream. And they're called flow, pull, and perfection. Okay, and you can find out more about that from reading the book, or I did some discussion that's in the proceedings. I did that yesterday morning. So what I really want to concentrate on is looking at value and the value stream. So why would we consider doing some things differently than we are right now? So I pulled together some statistics from a variety of sources. So Michael Ma would be really proud of me. I actually have statistics. So on-premise software, when you're delivering your software directly into the hands of your customer and asking them to own it, or the customer is insisting upon owning it, okay? On-premise software solutions are up to 90% more expensive to implement, customize, install, host, support, and train than on-demand software. Okay, that's quite interesting. Let's talk about non-efficient feature flow. This is one from pretty well known from the Standish Group. The horror that the overtime and the death marches that we're all doing to get features coded and tested and into the hands of the users. Only 20% of software features are often or always used. So 20% of all that overtime we did actually is the value that customers are getting out of the work that we've done. And a startlingly, disgustingly annoying fact is that 64% of actual delivered features are rarely or never used. Recently, a paper came out from Tom and Mary Poppendick where they were invited to come over to Scotland and look at a big insurance company there who said, we absolutely do not believe that about our software, because we're a lot better at figuring out what the customers want, what our internal business users need internally, and what our external end users need. And Mary and Tom said, okay, fine, you can believe that, but we're going to look at it. And then we'll tell you what we found out. And sure enough, 65% of their features were rarely or never used. So they were right, it wasn't 64%. Okay, and then poor resource efficiency. The typical value stream analysis of the waterfall software development process unfortunately shows that only 6% of our work tasks are actually value add. So again, I found this stuff out. It's there in the Lean Software Development book, From Concept to Cash, by Tom and Mary. So you can see that they're out there attacking waste with this kind of research that they're doing. So I highly recommend both of their books. All right, so stepping back from looking at this notion of waste in software, just to grab your attention a little and to let me stand on my podium for a minute here, let's use a model of waste called Planet Earth. All right, so you can't turn on the radio or the TV or open a magazine these days without hearing about the energy crisis, without hearing about the greening going on. I just saw a commercial the other day from the president or CEO of Johnson Products, and he was proud to announce that they located one of their plants next to a landfill so they could start to use the methane as an energy source for feeding their plant. So he was actually paying attention to the greening issue. Out in Boulder, we have these giant windmill farms where, right down the road from me, where we're generating energy from the natural massive gusts of winds that come fleeing down off of the Flatiron Mountains there. Well, okay, so why are we doing all that in the 21st century? Because back in the 20th century, we didn't realize that our model for creating value was going to catch up with us eventually. We actually didn't care about this stuff at all. So there's this model that we used called take, make, waste. All right? So whatever it takes to get the product out, it doesn't matter whatever detritus is left over. Just make it and get it out there. In fact, to get more product out there, just create more waste, okay? Because that doesn't matter. So we've been polluting the air and polluting the waterways because it was all in the interest of getting product out there. So what's the big deal? Okay, and we have these massive landfills of helping us not have to pay attention to how much waste we've been accumulating. So we have in this situation where we're trying to fix getting more product out there, we're creating a waste spiral. And so we're not paying attention. There's too long of a delayed feedback loop on what that waste impact is to us as we're delivering what we think is really good for the marketplace and for the world, for the human race in general. And so here we end up with these landfills, and we solved that waste problem by using something called shifting the burden. Okay, so have you heard about these barges that we now use to put the landfills in? Because the landfills are full? So instead of thinking about why are the landfills full, we solved the problem by bringing in barges and putting waste on barges. So that was a good idea. Okay. Little statistic about Americans, and this might be higher in Las Vegas, Nevada, that the average American consumer uses about 2,000 pounds of goods per year. It's actually in their hands, consumed, valued goods. And the raw materials it takes to get that out there for us, you know, because we really need all these things, is 1 million pounds. So if you do the math, we're getting 2% out of the raw materials that we're taking in. So in this system, there's a whole lot of waste sitting there. And we only are paying attention to it now, again, because we were willing to just shift the burden and use fixes that fail, like just taking landfill overloads and putting it on barges. Now, I know there are some Europeans in here, and I actually know a few Estonians, and I'm sure the Estonian numbers aren't that bad. But because I care to get my point across, I went with the U.S. numbers. So we assume unlimited resources here in the U.S. and that everything else is just someone else's problem. It's an externality. Well, in the software industry or high technology, I'll tell you that we're contributing to waste. in some startling ways, that we, again, shift the burden by shoving a bunch of our waste off to China. So 50 to 80% of US e-waste goes to China. So we don't have to look at it. We just keep upgrading systems and changing systems and getting new things. We require upgrades, okay, because we want to get these big feature sets out, so it requires upgrades of the hardware. So this is what we end up with, these piles of computers containing all these toxins. And so, unfortunately, I have to tell you, those of us that are in the software business are actually pushing this problem. We're actually asking for hardware to do more and more for us. So I want us to attack waste in our work, not just because of the value, which is what I'm going to mainly talk about, but actually also we're all involved in this other system of value and value stream. So just hold on to that with you as we go through the rest of the talk, if you don't mind. I work with Ryan Martins at Rally. Ryan was the founder of the company, and one time I was sitting around talking with him, and he mentioned that the driving force for him in deciding what the company would look like and what the software would look like came out of a book that had nothing to do with software, and it was called Natural Capitalism by Paul Hawkins. So he immediately ran into his office and gave it to me and said, you have to read this, because this is what got me where I am right now. This is actually my real passion. So he was wanting to attack waste in software back when he founded the company. I was pretty impressed with that, and because he's a smart guy, that was one of the reasons I started caring about this stuff. He also found out that you can think about attacking waste, and so again, using the Earth as a system model for us. So if we want to be attacking waste and moving towards zero footprints in software, and if we're looking for systems that can give us guidance on it, just the way we took lean thinking that had nothing to do with software and are applying that, here's some ideas. So a green business, according to conservationeconomy.net and Paul Hawkins, has sort of eight characteristics about it, or eight practices. So notice there are things like resource efficiency, okay? That's something we need to care about in software development if we want to increase our value stream. Waste as a resource, product as service, interesting, okay? So anyway, there's six others there that you can consider, that how would these impact what we're doing to protect our value in software delivery, and then pay attention to what we change about our value stream. So there are all these models sitting around us to help us. So with the Earth, there's a notion now that we move away from take, make, waste to take, make, recycle. All right, so always looking for ways that we can take waste out of the value stream called Earth and what we do, and have really concentrated value and recycle any waste that's out there. So we're attacking waste that way. So let's get that model in our heads, hold on to it, and look at how I would invite you to think about in the 21st century, as we're working on the waste issue in the Earth system, look at waste in our software systems. So I'm going to talk about software as a service, community-driven markets, and then fast feature throughput. So I'm attacking these issues of shifting the burden, fixes that fail, drifting goals, because this is what happened with the Earth. So let's pay attention to the fact that we've been kind of hiding under the covers and ignoring that that's been happening in the software business as well. So software as product, if you can remember my slide with all the statistics about the waste built into on-premise, the answer is to start aggressively looking at how you can deliver your software as a service. I invite you to think about that, and I'm going to show you why. So seek out a SaaS zero footprint for your product. With regard to that bloated feature set, we're 64%, and then this poor company in Scotland, 65%, discovered that we have feature delivery of rarely or never used features. We want to actually find the features that have the most stickiness to them, that really are what will stick in the marketplace, and raise that number up from 20% of always or often used. And so I recommend to you the notion of customer communities where you can open up and drive innovation with less cost. So rather than your marketing organization having to go out and drive market demand, the demand comes to you. You pull the demand through these communities. And I'll show you a little bit about that. And then finally, fast feature throughput. So Lee already mentioned I'm an Agile mentor. I have a passion around Agile. And so I want to fix these long feedback loops that we saw when we weren't paying attention to them in Earth. I want to fix them in software delivery by inviting a notion of fast feature throughput. And my recommendation is that Agile is the approach to use if you're really going to aggressively embrace fast feature throughput. All right, so software as a service is stop pushing the CDs and crossing your fingers and hoping that we get the thing delivered, and when it's installed, that it'll work and stay installed and working, and that the next upgrade that we send out will also work, sitting on top of the thing that they just last installed. Okay, so let's look at that. What resources does it take to support on-premise software? Well, you may be having to shrink wrap your software to get it out to your customers, so there's all the waste around that. That there's entire organizations I talk with when I go out and talk about Agile and Lean around the world where the main impediment to getting the software out isn't the development group, and testers, you'll be happy to know, it's not the testing group either. It's these people that need to do the what's called the packaging. So the whole packaging of what's a marketable product, because it's so expensive to declare the packaging that they have to be the final bottleneck to getting the value out. So there's this waste sitting there gobbling up the opportunity to get the value out there. All right. So we're kind of gift wrapping the stuff to get it out. And then we also have to use up a bunch of other materials to get it out to them. So gift wrap and marketing hype on the box aside, we're using up some other resources that cost the company money. Now, CDs have gotten cheaper and cheaper, but they still cost money. And again, massively producing them is a severe roadblock and bottleneck for companies to get their software out there. And then once we've delivered it into the hands of our on-premise users, they're now incurring cost by having all these systems and processors to run the software for them, okay? So that's our shifting the burden. Once we've passed it off to you, it's your problem. Or we could sell you a bunch of services to support you being able to use it. That's not a bad idea, okay? So because there's more going on once the software is out there. So you all know this, right? There's installing the upgrades. There's paying attention to the security around it, backing it up, and doing the restores, and then discovering that when the next generation of the product comes along, you own the problem of how to handle that darn end-of-lifing. It's your problem, okay? So when I think about that, and I think about software as a service, when Ryan was thinking about Rally and saying he decided to actually take a leap, because this is about 5 years ago, and he said, I'm going to go with this software as a service idea. Not really sure if the market is really ready for it, but I have this passion from having read this book by Paul Hawkins, and I want to do something in my world to eliminate waste. And he used his model, Salesforce.com. Do any of you use that tool or you know about that tool? So Salesforce.com is a CRM system. And that's a good model for me, too, because years ago, in many lifetimes ago, I was a programmer at Siebel Systems. I was actually in their professional services group. So have any of you used Siebel Systems in your organizations? So if you have, you know that to get to having your CRM solution up and running, there was extensive configuration of the product to get it into your organization, and then extensive customization to have it actually be usable by you once it was configured into your systems. So I think that actually was one of the downfalls for the organization, because Salesforce came along and said, we're actually not going to do it that way. So think about Siebel Systems over on the left, not to attack Siebel Systems, but because it was just doing what we did back in the 1980s and 1990s, okay? They were just following the model. And think about software as a service on the right, and look at the dramatic differences in what we do for delivery, development, pricing, allocation, the additional costs that go along with having it. As I mentioned, there was a lot of configuration and customization when we were getting these very rich product sets from Siebel out into the market. Sales focus, customer feedback loops or cycles, and then trying to profit capture and primary measures of success. So SaaS comes along and says, we invite you to think about those things differently. Think about a hosted environment as a way to deliver. So we're removing the waste of all the stuff that I showed you earlier. Think about very short cycle, continuous flow of value, because you're delivering into one place and you get to own and decide when the next upgrade will occur and when the releases will occur. Just go ahead and decide to do them more frequently, because you don't have to worry about shipping things out to all your customers. Pricing is by subscription. Allocation is actually, instead of having to worry about capitalization, I don't know how many of you have had to deal with that, but again, in some other previous lives, this is a huge issue as we're building software and how we get to recognize capitalization on it versus expense. So it's different with software as a service. And then so on with additional costs. We're doing the configuration just in our instance of the software. We're proving value in the first 90 days. So actually, when you have typically software as a service, you can sort of back out when you decide you don't want to use it anymore. And usually in the on-premise solutions, you're kind of stuck with these major three-year license deals or something. And then the feedback loops end up being very short. We have ongoing profit capture, so now there's value back into the organization for the revenue recognitions. And the primary measure of success is not how many new licenses can I get out there, but as I have subscriptions into my service, how can I cut down on churn? So I'm paying constant attention. That means I have to pay constant real-time attention to what the customers are using, what features they're valuing. So that's kind of cool. And it's attacking that waste of which features really are sticking, because you get to watch it all the time. Okay, so software as a service, we're removing all those things, those pictures I showed you of the boxes and the CDs and all the shifting of burden that we put onto the customers and the things that actually end up being shelfware. So again, different lifetime. Another software company I worked with, I'd go around as a professional services consultant to talk with them about their particular use of our replication server, just to call something out there. And I discovered that they had bought it a year ago and still hadn't installed it, okay? So it was sitting there and they just hadn't gotten around to using it. And at this point, they didn't really know if they were gonna use it, but they had paid the money for it and it was sitting there. So SaaS, one admin, one server version, one software version. The price of administration is actually not hidden away, shifted burden onto the customer. It's simply built in. It's understood as built into the price of the subscription. And then security isn't dependent on each individual location, but rather we concentrate our security resources in one location. So we amplify and are constantly improving and evaluating our security systems in one place and not hoping that the customer did it right on their location. So that's where I want to invite you to think about attacking waste with software as a service. Community-driven marketing now. So you've got this service, and you want to deliver the best features into it, because the whole idea is to have fast feedback loops on the features and avoid churn around the service. And cut down on that bloat of 64% and then increase the 20% of valued features. So how could we do that without having to create gigantic marketing organizations? I was recently interviewed by a gentleman, Richard Sharp, and he said, Gene, tell me some of the things you think about with regard to software, and what are some things that are going through your head right now? And he actually caught me on camera saying, well, I think you should fire your marketing department, and while you're at it, go ahead and fire your testing department. Out of context, that sounds pretty rude. So Richard was kind enough to be careful about what he put in the ultimate final cut of the tape. But this was one of the things I was referring to when I was jesting with him about firing the marketing department. That what we really want to do is build communities. So I use the notion of a hive of our community of customers and stakeholders, and they're the ones defining what should be in our software as a service. Okay? They're actually communicating with one another and declaring what should happen. An example of this actually that I experienced recently for a conference and all of the submissions of the proposals into the conference, everyone was invited to go in and vote on the proposals and provide a review on the proposals. Anyone could do this. And so when the conference committee came together to decide what would go into the conference, they had all this community feedback. The people that would be attending the conference had given the feedback to them. They'd never done that before. Okay? So you have this cross-pollinating going on as well, because as the users are sitting together in the hive talking about what they want, they're actually talking with one another and going, I never thought of that, or no, that really wouldn't help me at all. So just as the honeybees are bringing in different information from the various fields in which they play with flowers and their locations, and then cross-pollinating, in a community-driven marketing world in software, we'd like our user communities to do that for us and tell us ultimately what they want. Because we don't want to be creating inventory that's just going to turn into waste. We want to pull from them, rather push on them, what we think the feature set should be. So that helps us avoid defects running around in that 64% and having to have them manage the defects and then tell us about the defects, then we have to manage the defects. It helps us not build in undelivered features and unused features and commented out code. So all that waste, because we're paying attention to specifically what the users have asked for. So the example I'm going to give you is an online tool called Hive Live. So are any of you currently using Hive Live in your organizations for marketing? Okay, so I invite you to think about this. This is off their homepage, so I'm not going to read too much about it because that would take up the remainder of the talk, and I still want to get to a third topic. But look in the middle there. It says, community means cooperation, co-creation, and co-innovation. And creating an enterprise community for your business is one of the most significant steps you can take towards becoming a high-performance company. So that's really what I want to talk about with you. I'm not selling the Hive Live tool. I don't work for them. But that statement is what I want to talk about with you. Okay? And so Hive Live allows you to build communities of users. So in our company, we said, again, this was Ryan's idea because he wants to attack waste. He aggressively went after our marketing group and said, I want us to invite users talking with one another all the time. So this is our most prolific user, Chris Spagnuolo. I think he blogs something every other day. So I've asked Chris about reconsidering his lifestyle and his life choices. But it turns out that he's got some really interesting stuff to talk about. And we have a lot of other users that just sign up and start sharing stuff with them. So these are just people that aren't even actually users of our tool. They just want to be users of a community and impact the Agile community. So they share information with one another about the Agile community. So that's already kind of a marketing community in general around Agile. There, you get to start to see one voice emerge. You get to see where there's disparity, where the disagreements are, and then where the violent agreements are in the community. It's all out in the open. Okay, within our organization, our product marketing team set up a community specifically for our tool users. And so I want to point out that besides giving a lot of information to the users, so besides pushing information out to them, right there at the bottom, notice that it says, help us shape the future of Rally by submitting, commenting, and voting on future requests on the feature request tab. So if you've been listening to the discussions about Agile through this week, there's this thing called a ranked prioritized backlog of items that you work on. So what we try to do is just throw them all out there so anyone can know what's out there and being considered for the next release. And you go in and you get to like actually do little thumbs up or thumbs down and give your comment on why you think that's a good feature and what you would use it for, or why would anybody ever want that in your product? Who was the knucklehead that thought that up? Okay, so this has been a huge hit for the users to be able to own what the product ends up looking like. I really enjoy going out and looking at that. So that's the community, that's the idea of community-driven marketing. The marketing group in your organization declares open communities, complete open access to what a feature set could be, and they're the ones that drive it. They drive the innovation, and you pull the innovative ideas from them rather than having to figure it all out yourself. And then finally, fast feature throughput. So fast feature throughput says stop pushing large feature sets onto your organizations and crossing your fingers hoping you got it right, pushing large feature sets into your user communities. And maybe when you're doing that, if you didn't have the right marketing going on, you're actually going after the wrong user community, and now you're really building the wrong features, and you built tons of them. So all of these things feed one another with regard to, going back to Womack and Jones, define what value is and pay attention to your value stream, and think about when you're delivering your value and attacking waste. Looking at these three practices in particular is what you would embrace. So fast feature throughput, let's look at that. So I already mentioned Tom and Mary Poppendick. They were the people that first got me thinking about this because they said they'd been doing a lot of reading about lean out of the automotive industry and the lean principles out of Taichi Ono and the work that he'd been doing in supporting Toyota. And that they declared seven principles for attacking waste. The Japanese automotive industry, post-World War II, first of all, the entire Japanese economy had been decimated. And the Toyota family decided that we can really help rebuild. They had been in the fabric weaving business. And they said, the real place to go, the number one industry to be in is the automotive industry. So they came over to the US and looked at how we build cars over here and went back to Japan and said, well, the River Rouge plant in Ford gets this many cars out per minute And General Motors does that this way, and Chrysler does it that way. That's all fine and good. They're very, very successful, very profitable organizations. Well, they were, okay, back at the time they were being investigated. And Toyota said, the problem is we can't do things that way because there's so much bloat built into getting a car out there. So remember that take, make, waste model. They saw that back then. And they said, in order for us to do the same thing, we actually are going to have to do it completely differently. So rather than try to figure out how to get cars out as fast as possible with as many bells and whistles as possible so that we can generate revenue, we'll actually concentrate on eliminating waste and building integrity in. So at Chrysler and GM, and I speak about this having grown up as a GM brat, my dad was a GM executive, there was no such thing as stop the line. That was the last thing you would ever think of doing as a GM employee, because the measure of success was how many cars you got off the line per minute, okay? Toyota said, we're going to do the complete opposite. We're going to build integrity in, and so they have a notion of stop the line. So hold on with me here for a second, because I know I'm talking with you about fast feature throughput, and I just said to stop the line. But they said, anyway, you have to eliminate waste. And some of the ways to eliminate waste are empower teams. So find out from them how to narrow the waste out of the value stream. Find out where we're wasting motion and movement and handoffs and task switching and where we're waiting in getting the cars off the line and attack that aggressively. Learn from the team. So amplify learning. Encourage teams to give suggestions into how we do our work. A book by, I can't remember his name right now, his last name is May, The Elegant Solution about Toyota says they get 1 million suggestions a year from their employees. And it could be about any little thing. But the idea is the number of suggestions, not that it has to be some massive, great suggestion. And it could just be a small change in what they're doing. But it's because the employees have it constantly, it's constantly reminded of the fact that everything we do is about eliminating waste and building integrity in. So some other ways they do that is there's a whole notion of looking at the whole. So there's not sub-optimization of product development in one area versus another area. We look at the whole. Deliver fast and delay decisions. Those look like they don't fit with one another, but I talk about this quite a bit when I go out to software groups. You have to slow down to speed up. All right, and that's the same thing as stopping the line. Toyota now is the most productive automotive company in the world, and they get cars off the line twice as fast or whatever, I can't remember the statistic right now, than any of the automotive makers in the U.S. And they have a stop-the-line mentality, okay? So they deliver fast, and they delay decisions. And I'm going to show you one of the ways that they delay decisions and how they do work, and that we should consider that for fast feature throughput in how we do software development. So Mike Cohn talked a little bit about this. I don't know what other presentations you've been in about specifically about what Agile looks like, but the idea is that we rank items in something called a backlog. So think about my community marketing has helped me rank my items. And for any item, I don't declare it done. I don't keep testing until the end. So I'm doing that zero defect thing. I stop the line on any given item A, B, or C while I'm developing it. And I do it in short, quick time boxes. So at the end of any time box, because I wouldn't let anything go, quote unquote, off the line with any defects in it, at the end of any of these short iterations, I have done items. And so I can at any point as a product organization have a go, no-go decision. I get to decide go, no-go every 2 weeks, for instance, all right? And so there's examples of the ways that you do that, eliminating waste for small teams means that you just make everything into BVCs, big visible charts. So my picture on the left shows a team doing big visible charts, and I think that Michael showed some of that with the BMC software group and Follett software. Oh, I have to do a quick aside on that, okay. So this is a little Gene Tabaka thing. The BMC software case study, Michael failed to mention that I was the first Agile coach that they brought in. So that's pretty cool. So I was in there, and I actually was the person that did all those co-located release planning meetings. So it was really wonderful to sit in the audience yesterday and watch Michael talk about this customer that I started working with 4 years ago and where they've come. So anyway, he mentioned that because they have teams distributed in four different cities, that they needed to go beyond using just the sticky notes. So to cut down on waste and still have fast feature throughput, they went to automated tooling. Jeff Sutherland talks about that too, that once you go to larger teams, even if they're not distributed, you have to immediately consider an automated product backlog. It's in very large teams, whether co-located or not, this notion of keeping a prioritized release backlog becomes a bit too cumbersome to just manage with index cards or post-it notes. So here, fast feature throughput, I only work with the ranked features. I work with them one at a time. Now, why I chose paint chip pictures for this slide is sort of evading me right now. I like the picture a lot. But I was thinking about it and thought that when we're deciding to do some sort of work in our houses, we don't go and take every possible color. We narrow down the colors that we want and only go then buy the paint that we want. And then we also figure out which room we're going to paint first. So it's typically the living room and not the kids' room for pretty obvious reasons, right? So only ranked features are what we work on them one at a time. So fast feature throughput now, because I said I believe in this with my passion around Agile, starts to look like this. And I'm going back to the product manager who was gathering input from the community, okay? So think about that model of reducing waste. And now I have this model of how I collect customer needs is very different from the traditional approach than the Agile approach. Document requirements, prioritize requirements, validate requirements, assess the release status, manage changing requirements, assess the likelihood of the release date. It all looks quite different, and it's much faster in the Agile world. Because we have constant communication with our customers. That's written into the manifesto. Coarsely documented in user stories that await dialogue with QA and dev. All right, that's how we document the requirements. We delay the decision of exactly what the detail will be until the item has emerged to the top of the stack and we pop it off, and now that's when we get the final detail of it. So the detail emerges. We're prioritizing every iteration. So every 2 weeks, we can look at what's the most important thing to do right now. In seeing the whole of our organization, of our entire product set, what is the most important thing we should do in this iteration? We write acceptance criteria and then coordinate with our customers to validate it and approve delivery. So validating requirements, the user is actually engaged with us. And then daily stand-ups to assess how we're doing. Iteration demos to assess what those done items were back there. So let's see what's really done, what really got done. And don't let the defects run around with us. So demo it, prove that it works. And then use a burn-down chart to watch what it takes, what effort is it taking, what energy is it taking to get that doneness out there. Finally, requirements and priorities get to be evaluated at every iteration boundary, these punctuation points, I call them. And release dates don't change unless we want them to. But that's only because we decided the market wants more because they've kept bringing in their community-driven features and rankings, but you can decide to either release early or at this release time, or say, actually, because of the market voice that emerged, we'll go ahead and release one more iteration later. So we look at the scope of what the market wants and make decisions there. So the scope is the thing that tends to ebb and flow, truly. All right, this was what I was talking about with regard to what Toyota does for getting the best features out there. Fast feature throughput actually means, and I don't know too many software organizations doing this, so you might want to look into it. It's called set-based or concurrent engineering. So I'll use Toyota as an example, and we've done some of this at Rally, but imagine when they were building the Prius, they didn't decide and build a detailed requirement on what the radiator would look like at the very start. Instead, they said, we'll delay the decision of exactly what the detail of the radiator is going to be until we have had all the detail of all the other components coming forward, and we'll keep looking at the trade-offs. So we'll gather as many insights as possible before we make a decision. That's the intent. Gather insights, not nail down detail. Very different, okay? And so what they do is concurrent engineering, concurrent designs on radiators, and they're gathering insights on those. And then when they finally get to the point where it's time to implement the radiator component, they now have made a decision about efficiency versus size versus whatever else. You know, what are we really deciding are the most important parts of our radiator. So they never got stuck with a particular design and then had to deal with the fact that changing the design would be very expensive and costly. So that's what concurrent or set-based engineering does for you. Frequent retrospections help teams stay in flow. So they're constantly looking at what is working well with what we're doing so that we can get better and better at our estimates and therefore manage our workload better. And going back to the stuff from lean thinking, that actually reduces waste, and you actually, when you slowed down, helped you speed up. And so we watch agile teams. If they can maintain this notion of continuous flow, they start to get into a mode, and Michael showed that with BMC software, of becoming screamingly fast at their ability to deliver software. And it's through constant retrospection. So here are the benefits that you can reap if you're willing to embrace all this stuff. And this is just from three different reports on Agile, not necessarily on software as a service or inviting the community marketing. So organizations that were surveyed said that they enjoyed 93% increased productivity. Okay, imagine the amount of waste reduced when you have 93%. Increased productivity, 88% increased quality, 83% improved stakeholder satisfaction. Gosh, I wonder how that happened. I guess maybe they had the stakeholders defining what the feature set should be. They had them engaged. 49% reduced cost and 66% three-year risk-adjusted return on investment. So reasons for adopting Agile came out that really what they were looking for was better scope management of the projects, clearer creation of the requirements, and actually speed to or better predicting time to market. So that's what drove them to it. And I contend with you and invite you to consider that all of those things are proofs that the intent of Agile and fast feature throughput is to reduce and attack waste. So to sum things up, I'm inviting you to think about software as a service in the 21st century. If you don't, you're going to be left behind because that's where the market is heading. Even from 5 years ago, it's dramatically different, the number of companies that now offer software as a service. Look at this notion that as a system, it's emulating what we're doing with the earth, that we're inviting ourselves to become green and eliminate waste in what we do. So we have faster feedback loops. We invite communities to tell us what they want out of the feedback and the features. We use subscriptions rather than shifting the burden onto them to make sure the software is available to them. Limited install and built-in training delivers value faster. And then fast feature throughput helps check in with customer expectations very quickly. So we're not fixing the wrong things when we're putting features out. So now you can stop crossing your fingers and look for winning some Jolt awards in the next year. So I thank you for that, to think about that.